if you're dealing with a global algorithmic mutation rather than a localized mutation like in real biology, it may be that you've picked at random an algorithm and you give it as input your current organism and you start it running and it goes on forever and never gives you a new organism. So you've got to, by definition, say that you're not going to allow this. So this is actually amounts to having an oracle for the halting problem. You're eliminating mutations that never give you a new organism.
I see.
And using that, the software organisms can get more and more information. So they get n bits of information about the halting problem in time, roughly n squared, n cubed. Whereas if you pick the best possible mutation, you could get one bit each time you do a mutation. If you pick the best possible mutation to try, you could get one bit of information from the oracle and every time you try a mutation. But that would require the intelligence of picking the right mutation. Mutations are picked at random, right?
Uh-huh.
So that's not as good as intelligent design, shall we say. There's no intelligent design in this system. You're just trying to look at the fastest they could evolve and the slowest they could evolve and get an idea for what happens when you have Darwinian style evolution, how it compares. And the answer is it's surprisingly fast. I was surprised, maybe even a little disappointed that in...
Why? Why disappointed?
Well...
You wanted more work?
If the model collapses, becomes trivial, if you can evolve with Darwinian evolution essentially as fast as you do by picking the best mutation, this would mean the model is very unrealistic biologically. I would have been unhappy.
Well, just like you mentioned that there's the modern synthesis, there's also something that's more modern than that called extended evolutionary synthesis, which incorporates niche construction and epigenetics and stress-induced mutations. And I think multi-level selection is the rebranding of group selection, but it incorporates...
lots of stuff.
Like, look, the world is way more complex than traditional evolutionary theory would predict.
No, I agree.
And I'm sure there's going to be an extended version of that. So I don't see it as being a problem that your theory gets to something near optimal.
Okay. Well, that's kind of you. Yeah. Well, the question is how much of this you can make into a little mathematical theory where you can prove theorems. You know, once you make the evolution more realistic, if I had a body with a metabolism as well as the DNA in my little organisms, I would be in trouble. If I had a population instead of just one organism, I would be in trouble, although I think ectozenial.
Why is that the case?
Well, because the mathematics becomes a mess and I don't know how to prove any theorems. It may be my fault. You have to keep it simple enough that you can prove theorems.
So what you mean when you say that it becomes a mess for the world, but it becomes a mess for the mathematician trying to work on this field?
Prove theorems about it.
I see.
Now, maybe closer to reality, to what actually goes on in the biological world. So...
Sorry, Professor, I have a question.
You can say Greg.
Sorry, Greg. I have a question. In physics, there's something called effective theories, which says that it could be that the underlying... Okay, so there's turbulence, which says that you need to know the low-level details in order to predict something at the higher level. But then there are renormalizable theories, where it turns out that the low-level details don't matter much. So could it be the case that there's something like a renormalization of metabiology or some effective field theory where even though it's much more complicated at the bottom, like it's much more messy for the mathematicians to work on, there's something that's renormalizable that becomes tractable for the mathematician.
Yeah, that's a very good analogy. That's equivalent to Sidney Brenner saying, I don't care about metabolism or energy. You know, the cell will somehow manage that. I just want to know about information. And that's... It's that sort of gets you molecular biology. That's a similar idea, that what goes on underneath may really not be important to understand the system. The same way that you can understand what a computer is doing, the engineering, the physical implementation of the Boolean algebra, you know, the circuits, it doesn't show through in the software. The software tries to the software level wants to hide all of that, which is sort of similar to renormalization and the idea that what goes on at the bottom level may not be visible at the top level, and you can start with many bottom levels and get to the same top level, right? I don't remember what's that called, but you were referring to that, right?
Effective field theory.
Yeah. Yeah, so I feel very sympathetic to that idea. That's, I don't know what the right name for all of this is in this different context. It's when you create a new level of reality, what goes on at lower levels may be unimportant at that level. You know, you have to look at the concepts that are, you would look at the software level, right? You would forget about the hardware implementation of and or and other Boolean gates, Boolean functions in the transistors. So that's a similar idea. So anyway, to apologize for metabiology again, one nice thing about it is the normal version of Darwinian evolution says you want to be well adjusted. When I was in the 1950s in American schools, kids had to be well adjusted, right? The same with the normal view of biological organisms. And once they get well adjusted, they stop evolving unless the environment changes due to some cataclysm like, I don't know, volcanoes or a meteorite hitting the Earth. So I think that's a bad metaphor. I prefer, in my little model, you have open-ended evolution. The system can continue to be a better and better mathematician. So my wife has a little philosophy paper talking about the human self-image, depending on which model of biology you pick. And the notion that what you want to be is well-adjusted, you know, that you adapt to your environment and then you stop, evolution stagnates, is a picture that she finds, I also find, less attractive than the notion that evolution is open-ended and creative.
And is this related to Gödel's incompleteness?
I see it as being related, but that's because I'm sort of using the mathematics having to do with Gödel incompleteness theorem and Turing's work on the holding problem. I'm trying to make it into a sort of a toy version of biology, you see, the same way that no formal axiomatic theory is a theory of everything. So you can always have better and better theories. And I sort of take that and I sort of convert it into a statement in biology, which says the organism can keep evolving forever, you know, that the system is open-ended. So at the level that I'm looking at biology, the two problems are very similar. Actually, it's more similar to Turing's halting problem, but it's a similar idea to incompleteness, right? So I think that's a more attractive version. Actually, the version that Dawkins popularized of evolution is the selfish gene. And selfish genes are, I think it's a very ugly idea. You know, sexuality is very unselfish. When you have a child, you throw away half of your genome, the husband and the wife or whatever the couple is.
Wait, why do you see it as throwing away half of your genome rather than actually preserving half of your genome because it's going to go on?
Okay, but you're not selfish. It's not like a gene that says, I want to take over, I want to survive, you see? So my view of biology is that biology is creative. I don't think it's selfish, and I don't think you want to be well-adjusted to the environment. I think that biology is open-ended and endlessly creative. You know, that's because I like creativity. So this is my personal bias. So I come with a little biological model that reflects my love of creativity. Now, if you talk about, I'm not sure about what I'm about to say, but I've heard that the view of biology in Japan, for example, is completely different. In the United States, everybody believes that everything is selfish and organisms are competing, which is one possible point of view. In Japan, everybody thinks that everybody's cooperating, because if you look at the human body, it has billions of cells, which originally were independent organisms, but now they're cooperating to create a higher level organism. So if you are in a society which believes in cooperation and social cooperation rather than egotism and individuals competing to get rid of each other and be the success, then you make a theoretical biology in line with your view, you know. So my little toy model of biology stresses creativity, because incompleteness really is creativity. I view Gödel's incompleteness theorem not as a limitation of mathematics, and Turing's work not as a limitation. It was taken pessimistically. I view it as saying that mathematics is creative and will always be creative. You see, a formal axiomatic theory for all of math would give you absolute certainty, but it would also be a cemetery, you see.
Right,
so
right.
You change the viewpoint and you say, Gödel incompleteness is really good news. It's not bad news. It means our children and our grandchildren will always have new things to discover and new things to do. That it's not a closed system. It's an open system. And that connects pure mathematics, in my opinion, to biology at some very fundamental level, maybe. But not to real everyday working molecular biology, working with DNA. This is an attempt to sort of try to find the basic extract the basic mathematical ideas from biology. So another way to say what I'm trying to do, yeah, is von Neumann had this brilliant insight, I think, in that paper where he says that the key idea of computer technology and of biosphere is software, which gives you the plasticity of the biosphere and the successfulness. So I'm just trying to go one step further and see if I can get to a little theory about doing random mutations on software. It's just an attempt to carry the ball mathematically one little step further. Now, I agree that metabiology doesn't seem to have much connection with real biology, but actually my wife suggested that it might, and work by Hector Zanil and his collaborators has furthered this suspicion. You see, the question is, I'm not using point mutations. I'm using these global algorithmic mutations, which seem very powerful and very unrealistic. So my wife said, oh, well, one should go back to real biology and see if there's anything like that in the biosphere. You know, this may be a hint from pure math about what's going on. There is a piece of work by Hector Zanil and a few collaborators whose names escape me that I think was published in the Proceedings of the Royal Society A or something, where they're doing simulations of evolution roughly along the lines that I'm talking about. They're much more practical. They're not molecular biologists by any means. They are using ideas related to algorithmic information theory and Turing's work and all of that. But they are looking at algorithmic mutations rather than point mutations in their model. And they're doing simulations. I don't know if they were with populations. Maybe they were not individual. I don't remember. Anyway, it's very good work. And the result they found was that algorithmic informations actually sped up evolution. They looked good, actually, in their model. So
what I was referring to before about extended evolutionary synthesis, it goes by the name EES. It was because, I think it's Stephen Jay Gould and then this guy named Piglucci. I'll find the person's name and put it on screen.
It's not punctuated equilibrium, right? It's much more than that. Well, epigenetics. Yeah, but epigenetics says that the information is not all in the gene, right?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
If I'm not mistaken.
Sorry, it was developed because the indels and the single nucleotide polymorphisms were insufficient to explain the observed amount of complexity with traditional evolutionary thinking. There's nothing that's like mystical or fanciful about this. It's like niche construction, like I mentioned, and so known mechanism, multi-level selection. There is room for these global changes.
Yeah, that would be interesting to see if the stuff I'm suggesting looks analogous in some ways to this work. But my model is very simple. There's no epigenetics in my model. Everything is in the DNA, you know. But the truth is we're both, as you said, the fundamental motivation for this is this new version of Darwinism, and for my own work, is a suspicion that point mutations aren't enough, right? So in that sense, we're analogous. We were both worried about that problem. It doesn't seem to explain how fast things evolve, right? And it doesn't seem to explain the major transitions in evolution, like, for example, from single cell to multicellular, or the Cambrian explosion, for example, is very astonishing, maybe from the point of view of conventional Darwinism. I'm not sure if that's a reasonable statement or not. Yeah.
In this comparison that you have with the open system of biology, so to contrast that, generally we think of a fitness function and you just get to the minimum. Then once you get to the minimum, you stay there unless the fitness function changes. So that is that what you were saying?
No, well, my fitness function doesn't have a minimum. Organisms get fitter and fitter and fitter without limit. The fitness is a number, and the bigger the number, the fitter the organism. This is how I avoid, this trap of the well-adjusted child in 1950s schools, American schools, or the selfish gene. The way I avoid it is the fitness function, you don't minimize it, you maximize it. And it can be as big as you want. This is how you get open-endedness out of this little model of biological evolution, you see.
To make a parallel between physics again, in physics, when you have an open system, it means you're open, again, relative to something else. You're a subsystem of something else. So what is this something else in this case? And then what is the border in between it that allows an exchange?
Well, the environment, the organisms are getting more information from the environment in this little model. And what corresponds to the environment is an oracle for the halting problem, which is an infinite amount of information.
So does this require a philosophical commitment to Platonism?
Well, this model is non-computable, so it's not even an algorithmic model. It involves software, but there are steps in it that require an oracle for different things. So in that sense, it's a Platonic model. The idea, you see, the problem is, I wanted to get the simplest, okay, what is life? Okay, now one definition, I was reading books by John Maynard Smith, whom I had the pleasure of meeting, by the way, north of the Arctic Circle at Abisko, Sweden. He's a fun guy. He was already retired and we would go off and drink beer. There wasn't much to do north of the Arctic Circle, so we would go off and drink beer and talk. Anyway, Maynard Smith has two books written with a chemist, a Hungarian chemist called Erich Szathmáry. And I think both books have a chapter or a section at the beginning where they ask, what is life? And their definition is, well, you might think that a flame is alive, right? Because it reproduces itself, because more things catch on fire. But they say a flame doesn't evolve. It doesn't incorporate more information. So it would be a system that by evolution gets more complicated and evolves. So I took that as my definition of life in my little toy model. In other words, it may look like a vicious circle because my definition of life in his little model is a system that evolves by Darwinian evolution. So that sounds like you're supposing that Darwinian evolution works to start with. But it's not really a vicious circle because you want to find the simplest Pythagorean or Platonic life form that provably evolves by natural selection. So that would be, it's not the individual organism that's alive in this point of view. It's a system that evolves by natural selection that's alive. And you want to find the simplest system you can find in the world of pure mathematics that you can prove evolves. And then that would be alive in some sense. But it's not, in this model, it's not the individual organism that's alive. It's the fact that there's a process which whereby it incorporates more information and evolves. I have a lot of this stated in that little book. I have to admit, some of it is not terribly fresh in my mind at this point in time.
That's fine. When you were talking about that there's always something new to discover in this.
Right.
Is it a guarantee that what's new to discover is of an interesting class? And the reason I say that is, there's, for instance, a video game called No Man's Sky. And what it is it's a procedurally generated world. And so there's an infinite amount, well, for all intents and purposes, an infinite amount of planets. But once you've visited 10, you've pretty much visited them all. So yes, there is something new to do, but it's not relevant, it's not alluring. Future Kurt here, editing himself in for clarity. I was being facetious. No Man's Sky is a wonderful game. I've never seen a developer turn around a game's quality like I have with this with Hello Games. It's unprecedented. Thank you to the development team. Sean Murray, if you're watching, I'd love to have you on the podcast. Great work to all of you. Back to the show.
Well, that's a very good question. For example, Gödel's incompleteness theorem, you can argue that the theorem that Gödel, well, the statement that Gödel constructs, which is true but unprovable within the system, is not of any interest to anybody. So, for example, people can say, I don't care about proving that finite bit strings are algorithmically irreducible or have high program size complexity. This is not something a normal mathematician wants to do in their everyday work on the problems that interest them. And you can also say, regarding the halting probability or the omega number, it may be true that the bits are unknowable in a sort of the worst possible way. They're algorithmically irreducible. They show that the Platonic world of pure mathematics has infinite information content or infinite complexity. Mm-hmm. But what do I care about the bits of the halting probability? You know, it doesn't come up in, I don't know, in algebraic geometry, for example, or in work that real mathematicians are passionate about and working on all the time. So you can argue that it's open-ended, but not in any interesting way. And let me give another example of this. You know, I said Hilbert's program was destroyed by Gödel in 1931, but for all practical purposes, there are now formal systems where you can formalize real mathematics, the kind of real mathematics that real mathematicians do. There are some mathematicians who are doing very complicated, very good mathematicians who are doing very complicated proofs, and they wanted some assurance that the proofs were correct. And they took these proofs and formalized them, put them into a system now, which could check the proofs. So for all practical purposes, there are now theories of everything for all the mathematics that people are doing now. And this is a tremendous engineering achievement. This is very good work, building on software techniques and logic and everything like that. And it's true that these systems are incomplete, according to Gödel's incompleteness theorem. But it doesn't matter, because people can do all the mathematics that real mathematicians want to do now. So these are very powerful systems for formalizing proofs. People have done things like, I think, checking the proof of the four-color theorem, if I'm not mistaken, and other kinds of results by formalizing them in these systems. And some of the mathematicians who've done this said they got a deeper insight into the problem by formalizing it. So instead of complaining about the work of inserting a proof into this special language and breaking it into pieces that the proof checker that comes with all this software could check were correct, you have to break the proof down into pieces small enough that the software can say, okay, I got that, that's correct, let's go on to the next step. Instead of complaining about this, because these systems are getting smarter and smarter, so they can you can take leave bigger and bigger holes in the proof.
That's super interesting.
Yeah. And for all practical purposes, Hilbert was right. There are now very good formalizations of all of working mathematics at this time. So that's in contrast, that's an interesting philosophical tension with Gödel's incompleteness theorem, which says that you can't do a theory of everything for all of math, but you might be able to do a theory of everything for all the math that in practice mathematicians are doing now.
And that's,
in fact, has happened for all practical purposes, right? F-A-P-P. So that, from a philosophical point of view, that's an interesting tension, I think. And it's sort of like programming a program, because you've got to put your proof into a logical language that is of the system you're working with. And you have to break the proof into steps that are small enough that the software can check that they're correct, that step in the proof. This is actually a practical tool now. So in a sense, Hilbert's program has been carried out, that part of it at least. There were a lot of historical aspects to the original proposal of Hilbert, which are of less interest nowadays, I think. But the basic idea is what I've been trying to explain. So it may be that the system is open-ended, but not in a way that people care about that much, you know. On the other hand, real mathematics is progressing. It's progressing very well. The century of Gödel's and Capena's theorem, the 1900s, was a century of tremendous progress in mathematics.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.